Welcome to the Novus Visual Protocol Series. In this video, we will learn how to perform all phases of chromatin immunoprecipitation from lysate prep to DNA quantification. This visual chip protocol follows the written version located on the support section of our website, as well as the protocol for the Novus Chromatichip kit. This kit includes all the components necessary for you to perform a successful chip the first time you use it. Chip can be effectively completed with either cell culture or tissue lysate. Here, we will demonstrate the procedure with one flask of 80% confluent HeLa cells. Start by adding formaldehyde directly to the medium to reach a final concentration of 1%. Incubate at room temperature for 10 minutes. To quench the cross-linking reaction, we next add enough glycine to the flask to reach a concentration of 125 millimolar or 1x if you have a 10x solution. Incubate for 5 minutes at room temperature. Remove all medium and rinse twice with ice-cold PBS. Next, add 4 mL of ice-cold PBS that also contains appropriate protease inhibitors to prevent degradation of your proteins. Scrape the cells into solution and transfer to a 15 mL conical tube. Pellet the cells by centrifugation at 4 degrees Celsius for 5 minutes at 800 G. Discard the supernatant and resuspend the cells in 400 microliters of RIPA lysis buffer and appropriate protease inhibitors. Transfer the cells to a siliconized microcentrifuge tube and incubate on ice for 15 minutes. After this, you're ready for DNA shearing. In the second phase of chip, we will use a sonicator equipped with a microtip to shear our DNA to fragment sizes of 100 to 1,000 base pairs. The conditions for shearing must be empirically derived and optimized before proceeding to any of the following phases. Results vary depending on your equipment, cell type, cell density, cross-linking efficiency, and shearing conditions. However, there are several general tips for successful DNA shearing. First, keep the sonicator tip close to the bottom of the tube and limit the volume to 400 microliters. This will prevent foaming of the sample, as foaming decreases the efficiency of the sonication procedure. In addition, perform a time course of multiple short sonications instead of fewer, longer treatments. This minimizes heat buildup and unwanted denaturing of your chromatin. For example, we find that 6 15-second pulses at 50% power output works well for us. Placing the sample back on ice to rest for at least 60 seconds between pulses will cool the sample back down. After the samples have been successfully sheared, centrifuge each at 4 degrees Celsius for 5 minutes at 12,500 G. Remove the supernatant and transfer to a new tube or aliquot into 10 40 microliter samples. These samples can be safely stored at negative 80 degrees Celsius for up to 1 month. To test for shearing efficiency while optimizing this phase, and optionally afterwards, run one aliquot of your sample on a 1.5% agarose gel. To do this, dilute the 40 microliter sample with 160 microliters of IP elution buffer and 8 microliters of 5 molar sodium chloride. All buffers are detailed in the written protocols found in the support section of the Novus website. Incubate at 95 degrees Celsius for 15 minutes. Finally, run 10 microliters of the diluted sample with loading buffer and DNA binding dye alongside a 100 base pair ladder to verify fragment size. Here is an example of DNA that has been undershared in lane 2, perfectly sheared in lane 3, and overshared in lane 4. And here is a spectral image of the same gel. Note the even distribution of fragment sizes in lane 3. You can now proceed to the immunoprecipitation phase. In the third phase of CHIP, we will use a novus antibody that is specific for our protein of interest to pull down DNA that is cross-linked to that protein. This is done by using magnetic beads conjugated to a protein A and or G that will bind to the antibody-protein-DNA complex. Start by diluting samples 1 to 10 by adding 40 microliters of sheared chromatin to 360 microliters of IP dilution buffer and include protease inhibitors. All buffers are detailed in written protocols found in the support section of the Novus website. It is beneficial to IP at least 3 samples. One will be for your antibody of interest, another will be for a positive control antibody, and a third for a negative control which will not contain any antibody and will be used to measure background levels. If you are using the ChromataChip kit, your kit includes a positive control antibody. Dilute one last sample and label this input. This sample will not go through the IP process and instead be saved for phase 4 of the protocol. Store this at 4 degrees Celsius until ready for use. Add your antibody of interest and positive control antibody to their respective diluted samples. Then incubate overnight at 4 degrees Celsius with rotation. The next day, for each sample to be IP'd, you will use 25 microliters of fully resuspended protein AG magnetic beads. First, wash the beads by adding 1 mil of IP dilution buffer to the amount of beads you will be using for all of your samples, and then vortex. Then pellet the beads with a magnetic separator and resuspend the beads with the same volume of IP dilution buffer as your original volume of beads. Add 25 microliters of wash beads to each sample and incubate tubes with rotation for 1 hour at 4 degrees Celsius. Next, we can begin our wash steps. Wash steps can be performed manually through the use of a rotator and magnetic separation rack, or automated with a machine designed for this use. Start by pelleting the beads and removing the supernatant. Then add 500 microliters of cold IP wash buffer 1 and wash for 5 minutes at 4 degrees Celsius with rotation or agitation. Repeat this entire step for IP wash buffers 2, 3, and 4. Elute the complex from the beads by adding 200 microliters of IP elution buffer and washing for 15 minutes at 4 degrees Celsius with rotation or agitation. Pellet the beads, keeping the supernatant and discarding the beads. In phase 4, we will reverse our initial cross-linking of proteins to DNA, followed by purification of the DNA. start by taking each IP sample, as well as the input sample which did not go through the preceding IP steps, and add 8 microliters of 5 molar sodium chloride to the 200 microliter samples, followed by vortexing. Incubate at 95 degrees Celsius for 15 minutes. To purify each sample, we'll use a DNA binding silica column according to the manufacturer's instructions. First, add each sample to the proper amount of DNA binding buffer and vortex. Then, transfer each sample to a column placed inside a collection tube. Centrifuge the columns at 15,000 G for 1 minute. Discard the flow through from the collection tube and add DNA wash buffer to each column. Centrifuge the columns at 15,000 G for 1 minute. Discard the flow through from the collection tube and spin the empty columns at 15,000 G for 2 minutes to ensure that they are completely dry. Discard the old collection tube and place the purification column into a new clean tube. Add 50 microliters of DNA elution buffer directly to the membrane in the column. Allow to sit for 1 minute, then perform a final spin at 15,000 G for 1 minute. Discard the purification column and save the purified DNA at minus 20 degrees Celsius until ready for the last phase. In this final phase of chip, our precipitated and purified DNA can now be measured through a variety of techniques such as traditional PCR, quantitative real-time PCR, microarrays, and chip sequencing. Here, we will use QRT-PCR to quantitate the amount of protein associated with a specific gene locus with the use of specific primer sets. Multiple loci can be analyzed by using different primer sets. Start by making a master mix for each primer set that will be used, adjusting volume for your amount of samples. If using the ChromataChip kit, your kit includes a positive control human primer set. 2 microliters of purified DNA sample template can then be added directly to the wells containing your master mix. For the input sample, first dilute the sample down to 1% of the original concentration before adding it to the wells. Using the input sample at full concentration will typically result in aberrant data. After performing RT-PCR according to the manufacturer's instructions for both the thermocycler and the DNA polymerase mix you used, the data can now be normalized. The final data is typically represented as a percentage of amplified sample signal relative to the input sample, which contains the maximum signal possible. More detailed instructions on how to normalize your data can be found in the support section of the Novus website.